Good morning. I got to shaking hands and lost track of time. Good to have all of you with us today for our worship service. Welcome to everybody on Facebook, everybody who's here for our service this morning. It's so good to have you. We're going to worship the Lord together. And I just want to take a moment. I got a birthday check today from Chris Hall. He's getting a little older, so I'm not going to make fun of him, but he is 59 years old today. Let's give him a big round of applause. Appreciate you, Chris, your faithfulness. And we are going to have a great service here again today. God's just been blessing us in so many different ways. We're so glad that you're here with us. Let's pray and we'll begin. Father, thank you for this opportunity to be in this place we call your house. It's set aside for you, for your purposes, and for the building up of your kingdom. And we pray that today you'd be pleased, honored with all that we do. Help us to sing and to give and to serve and to listen and to respond in the way that you would have us to respond today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you would stand with us as we begin to sing together.
Then we will no longer be immature like children. We will be tossed and blown about by every wind of new teaching. We will not be influenced when people try to trick us with lies so clever they sound like truth. Instead, we will speak the truth in love, growing in every way more and more like Christ, who is the head of his body, the church. He makes the whole body fit together perfectly. As each part does its own special work, it helps the other parts grow so that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of love. So with the Lord's authority, I say this, live no longer as the Gentiles do, for they are hopelessly confused. Their minds are full of darkness. They wander far from life. God gives because they have closed their minds and hardened their hearts against him. They have no sense of shame. They live for lustful pleasures and eagerly practice every kind of impulse. But that isn't what you learned about Christ, since you have heard about Jesus and have learned the truth that comes from him.
The house of the Lord. could ever bring. Worthy of every breath you could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you.
Sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, want us to sing that verse and that chorus again. I would just like to invite you and encourage you as we sing this verse and chorus of I Send a Raw. Maybe put your hands in front of you, whatever you want to do, but do something, sing from your heart as an indication that as we enter into this service and this time where we're going to hear the Word of God, that God, I'm surrendering my all to you afresh and anew. Let's sing that and let's continue in worship together.
All to Jesus I surrender all. To Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily. I surrender all. I surrender all to Thee.
Father God, we thank you for all that you've done for us. In view of your great mercy, if we gave you our all, it would not be enough. For you gave us your all, and your all was your Son. And your Son came and lived a perfect life and died on a cross for our sins and rose again from the dead. And he told us that if we would just surrender our lives to him, he would come live inside of us and make something completely brand new out of our lives. As Marcy sung to the families this past Thursday, you make something beautiful out of the mess of our lives. God, I thank you for what you've done in my life. I'm still a mess, but I'm a lot less of a mess than I was a few years ago. I thank you for your grace and for your mercy. And God, I just want to say I surrender all to you afresh and anew. Father, there are many who are sick in our congregation, and I know that Charles Mayfield is in the hospital right now. We ask that you'd minister to him and comfort him at this time. And Steve Patton has been back in the hospital. We're not sure what's going on there. And they represent so many others in our church family with ongoing sicknesses and dangerous situations even. And we're asking that by your grace and your mercy that you would stretch forth your hand to heal, to do miraculous signs and wonders. You said that you would provide for every one of our needs according to your riches and glory in Christ Jesus. And God, we have banked our future, our health, everything, our eternity on those verses. And we pray that in this service that you would be glorified and honored, that you'd be lifted up and pleased with all that we do. May we respond today in a way that would please you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. You can be seated at this time. Deb Wellhoff is going to come forward at this time for a special presentation.
We'll give the ladies just a minute. Good morning. Morning Sunday. Isn't it a beautiful day? I have been asked to say thank you to a couple of people. You know, our preacher and our staff and Austin and Kim and Rocky, they keep us running. So and I know that every day each and every one of them pray for us individually and as a group. And because of them we continue to grow, we continue to do all those. Ladies, come on up. So if Rocky and Kim and Austin and Pastor Steve would come on up. October, as you know, in the Nazarene Church is Appreciation Month. So with that, again, everybody, thank you for gifts. If you've been unable to give a gift yet, I know that they would take a card like on a Tuesday instead of a Sunday too. So please share. Again, let's give them a round of applause because without them, we couldn't do this. So ladies, thank you. And again, thank you.
Say thank you on behalf behalf of our whole staff. You can go ahead and come on up. It's not like a... You're welcome. Well, I want to say thank you on behalf of our whole staff. Thank for your gifts, for your support. You make leading easy. I saw on Facebook, one of my friends just said today's his last, maybe his last day pastoring, and it's happening so much. We're seeing this happen over and over again with people, pastors who are kind of checking out early, unfortunately. I hate to see that, but you make it so easy to lead, and I want to thank you for doing that. We've had to go through some tough times together the last 3 years, and even in the midst of those difficult times, you look around, God is blessed, we're growing, new people are coming to the Lord, new ministries are starting, and that's a testament to your faithfulness, and I want to thank you for that. Ushers, if you'd go ahead and come on forward at this time, we're going to take up our regular tithes and offerings. I just want to say again, I'm so grateful for you and your faithfulness. If you're a guest with us today, there's a couple things you could do. We have a worship connection card in the worship folder that you could fill out. We've also gone digital here. We have a QR code. If you know how to do those things, I'm still kind of learning the QR code thing a little bit, but you can go on the QR code. You can communicate with us with that QR code. It's in your worship folder. You can ask for prayer requests. Your first, second, or third time guest, we just encourage you to fill that out. It's how we keep you up to speed with what's going on at the church. And it just so happens that next week we're having pizza with the pastor, and my wife Marcy will be there. And we do that as a way to get to know some of the new folks that are coming to the church. And we would just encourage you to fill out on the connection card or with the QR code if you're planning on coming to that. We just need to know how much pizza to get for that event. So again, thank you for your faithfulness. Let's pray for this offering. God, thank you again. I thank you for this people. I thank you for your faithfulness and your goodness to us. You are so amazing, and we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you as you give at this time. show them our appreciation for all that they do for us. Great to see the way the worship team is growing. Abby's on her way back. If the kids want to join her for Kids Church, you can just meet her in the back of the room, and she will take you back for that. Thank you, Abby, for all that you do to lead our kids on Sunday morning. 29 years ago, Marcy and I stood before our pastor, family, friends to be married. And at the altar that day, we gave our pledge of faithfulness, devotion to one another. We exchanged I wills and I do's together that formed the foundation of our lives. And God, in a miraculous way, through that vow and commitment, formed two people into one. We've been on that journey now, as I said, for 29 years. We went on our honeymoon. It was a wonderful honeymoon in Eureka Springs, Arkansas. We've got to go back many times since then. It's just a wonderful place, one of our favorite places to go. And we got back from the honeymoon and kind of dove into life, right? And all of a sudden, stresses started coming and sickness started coming. And, you know, there's nothing like marriage. It's kind of like a magnifying glass on every immaturity, every insecurity that you have, every selfishness and selfish ambition, everything that's wrong with us. Marriage just has a way of kind of shining that on us, because we're learning a new way to live, and we're having to learn what it really means to love. I mean, it's one thing to be in love, but it's one thing, another thing to love over the long haul. And a lot of people think it's got to be in love all the time, but God calls us to love one another. And I would say that that initial day, those initial I wills and I do's, formed a foundation for our life together as a couple. And we didn't know all about marriage, obviously, at that point, but that's okay. We were still very married, right? And it's like Dr. Shaver says in the devotional, Living in the Blessing, if you want to enjoy the married life, you have to get married. So that was the initial beginning. Now, I'm actually not preaching on marriage today. Caught you, didn't I? I'm actually preaching on growth in the Christian life. And I believe that there are a lot of similarities between our marriage relationship and the Christian life. We've had a great run here just the last few months of several people accepting Jesus. I think I've counted 8 to 10 people just since last February that have accepted Jesus. We've baptized them. They've made, in a sense, initial vows to God, right? They've signed on. God, Adam said it last week, I'm dedicating my life to you. Or was it Randy? Both of them said it in different ways. I'm dedicating my life to you. That's what we do in marriage. In fact, the Bible calls us, the church, the bride of Christ. So we've made these initial vows, and they've been baptized as a public sign. That's kind of like the marriage ceremony, isn't it? We declare in public, just like we declare to our spouse that I'm going to love you for the rest of my life. We declare in public that we're going to love and obey God the rest of our lives. And there's a honeymoon phase for the new Christian. I mean, there's just this euphoria. Do you remember those days when you first accepted Jesus and just how wonderful it felt to know that all your sins are forgiven? And you can't explain it, but it's just like something is so different inside of me, right? And it would seem that it's going to be like that for the rest of our lives. And I will say that Jesus is going to be inside of you for the rest of your life. But I will say that that phase doesn't last forever, because real life is going to happen. Stress is going to happen. Sickness is going to happen. We're not exempt from anything because we've given our life to Jesus. In fact, I told you before, the truth of the matter is now that you're a Christian, you got this fellow, the devil, who's really upset, and he's after you even more than he was before then. But Jesus is in you, and that makes all the difference in your life. And the longer you go in your Christian life, you start to notice, just like maybe in your marriage relationship, some immaturities in your Christian life, some insecurities in your Christian life, some stubbornness, some selfishness in your Christian life. And you don't quite know what to do with that. You don't know how to handle those issues. But if you stick at it, and if you don't give up, and if you keep going and keep relying on Jesus, the Christian life is not the easy life. The Christian life, we talk about being saved by grace through faith, not of works, so that no one can boast. The gospel is not opposed to effort. The gospel is opposed to earning your salvation. So after we're saved, there's an effort that has to go into this. A lot of effort. Just like getting in shape physically takes effort. It takes effort to grow spiritually. It does not happen automatically. It does not happen by osmosis. You've got to put effort into it. And if you put the effort into it, if you allow God to go to work on the inside of you and stick at it, just like a marriage that goes 50, 60 years and has put the effort in. You know, not every marriage that lasts 50 or 60 years is beautiful. Some of them have just tolerated each other that long, right? You've seen that. But the ones who have put effort into it and worked through those issues, there's a sweetness to those marriage relationships, isn't there? You've seen it. And the Christian who puts the effort into it for that length of time, there's just something so different. It's like when you're around them, it's like you're in the presence of Jesus, right? And you want to know what you are. Because here's what's happened. Over a course of 50 years or so, Jesus has literally been formed in them. It's almost like you are in the presence of Jesus, because that person has surrendered themselves to Jesus and allowed him to do whatever needs to be done. So the Apostle John calls that perfect love. That's what we've been studying a lot here recently. It's in 1 John 2, 12-14. If you've got your Bibles, if you want to get your phones out, we'll have it on the screen as well. But there is a pattern, I believe, in these verses for us that can be followed in this journey of becoming like Jesus. In fact, why don't we read this together? I am writing to you, dear children, because your sins have been forgiven on account of his name. I am writing to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. I am writing to you, young men, because you have overcome the evil one. I write to you, dear children, because you know the Father. We can do better than this. I can't even hardly hear you, folks. I write to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you are strong and the word of God lives in you, and you have overcome the evil one. Good job. So there is a progression there in that passage, I believe. We've been studying this little book of 1 John. It was actually a letter that was written to churches in Asia. We've talked about that. And he's dealing with some false teachers. And these false teachers are causing havoc, and they're teaching crazy things like you can love God and not obey God. And in order to deal with them, John is having to say some very hard things. And he says, if you're not obeying God, you're not a follower of God. If you don't love like God loves, you're not a follower of God. And keep in mind who he's writing to there. He's writing to false teachers who are trying to lead people astray. So you can understand, I think, that he feels the need to kind of get in their face a little bit, right? They're causing havoc in the church. You know, sometimes we think Christians have to always be nice. Well, I'm not saying we should be rude or a jerk. There's a little girl at the preschool. One of her phrases is, boy, they're just being jerkish, aren't they, Marcy? We don't have to be jerkish, right? But sometimes somebody needs to be direct and take the bull by the horns and say, this is going to stop, right? And that's what John does with these false teachers. And a lot of commentators like myself think that as John gets deeper into this letter, he starts to think, okay, and I think the Holy Spirit nudged him here. He's saying, John, we want to be careful. There are some new Christians here who, you know, you've been going so hard after these false teachers, they're going to start to doubt their salvation. And it's kind of like he backs up a little bit and says, okay, you true Christians, there is a process involved here. And he lays out three categories of people, dear children, young men, and fathers. Let me say this, and this is going to form a foundation for a lot of what we're going to do the rest of the message. Stages, growth, process, and moments of surrender are all part of the Christian life. Let's read that one together. Stages, growth, process, and moments of surrender are all a natural part of the Christian life. He says, children, know God and love the Father and have the assurance of their sins. That's referring to new Christians, the baby Christians. They're young in their faith. and they are euphoric, and they should be, and we're so excited for them. It's just like when a toddler comes over to your house for your grandparents, right? It just lights everything up because they're your grandkids. And we have new people in the family. They're excited about it. And if they continue on in a natural progression, they become young men and women who know the Word of God and therefore are strong and have overcome the evil one. For new Christians, I want to talk to you real quick. You got to start the habit right now of getting in the Word of God, even if it doesn't make sense. You got to do it. You got to do it every day. Paul called it the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. It'd be like going into battle without your weapon. You got to get in the Word of God. YouVersion is a great way to do that. It's an app if you want to get it. If you haven't started it, you need to get into it as soon as possible. You will not last. You will not be here a year from now. You will not be here a year from now if you're not doing this right now and don't start. I can guarantee it 100% of the time. And they're on the front lines. They're fighting. And then fathers and mothers in the faith, they possess a sweet, full, intimate relationship with God, their Father. And we are so blessed as a church. We have many of these here at this church. I remember when I was a pastor in Wauseon, Ohio, starting a church, I looked around one night. There wasn't a gray hair on that board. We were all just a bunch of young people. And I remembered one night thinking, well, how in the world can we lead a church without some people who have been through these battles? We were all in our 30s, I think, if I recall correctly. I literally started praying, God, would you send us some people with gray hair? I did, because we needed the wisdom. We had a lot of energy, and we did a lot of good things. I'm not putting anything down. The amazing things happened at that church, but we just needed some good seasoned leadership at that time, and we have that here. And I think it would be worthwhile. There's another group that I think is worthy of remembering on Pastor Appreciation Day. I see Rocky here. I don't see Jerry's not here. Hugh Falls. Would all of our retired pastors and their wives stand up real quick? I want us to give them a round of applause this time. Go ahead and stand up there. Mary Lou, Dwayne. These folks who have been through the battles, they have fought long and hard. And Rocky and I talk regularly. Some of them get together and pray with me. Who better to pray for I'm going to call myself a young pastor here just for fun. a young pastor than for some retired pastors to come along and pray for them. I'm so grateful for them. Let me give you some qualifiers on this. I'm not talking about biological age here. I'm talking about spiritual age. You can be 70 years old and be a new Christian and be a spiritual baby. Nothing in the world wrong with that. In fact, you are a miracle because it just doesn't happen very often. Praise God for you. And don't worry that you don't have as much time as some others to grow and all this stuff. You've got all eternity to grow and become more like Jesus and enjoy his presence. You haven't lost anything. God bless you. I would also say that just because you've been a Christian for 50 years doesn't mean you're a spiritual father or mother. If you don't put the effort in, you can still be a spiritual infant or adolescent as well. I would need to add as well that it's very natural, it's very normal, these stages. We don't expect our 2-year-olds to do what 12-year-olds do. We don't expect our 12-year-olds to do what 22-year-olds do. And in the spiritual realm, we don't try to make spiritual infants act like spiritual 15-year-olds and 15-year-olds like 25-year-olds. The churches that do that lose them. We need to be a place with enough love to keep them warm. That's the kind of church that God's looking for. That's the kind of church God will send new Christians to, folks. And God's sending new Christians to us, so He must see something here, right? Because think about it, parents. Would you send your kids to a daycare that you didn't think was going to take care of your kids? Absolutely not. God knows who's going to do that. He sees the hearts. I think he's at least as smart as we are. Would you give me that one? Maybe I'll get an amen there. I mean, he knows what he's doing. He knows what's best for his kids. I would say also that if a Christian gets stunted in one of these stages, it's not good. It's not normal. Here are some things that can stunt us. Sin can stunt us. Maybe we get locked up in a habitual sin that keeps us from moving forward. Maybe God challenges us to move forward, and we refuse to move forward. I was thinking about this whole issue. There are Christians who have been a Christian for a long time who really haven't grown the last 20 years. Some would wonder if anything is happening at all spiritually there. I would say this at the very least. You are at least probably a poster child for everything that non-Christians see wrong with Christianity today. That they are seeing a person who calls himself a Christian who's not acting like a Christian. And, you know, they're just looking for excuses, and if they see one, they're going to use it. Lack of time in the disciplines, spiritual disciplines, prayer, church attendance, time in the Word. If we are not investing in those areas, we will not grow. Bitterness is a huge one. Bitterness and resentment. A refusal to forgive. Today, I told you we're looking at stages, moments, process, and moments of surrender. I'm going to deal with the moment of surrender today, and we're going to move on to the process next week. Just as the natural process of marriage leads to surrender, I believe that the natural process of the Christian life leads to surrender. Now, remember here, we have free will. 50% of marriages today, the last time I checked, still end in divorce. So what happens too many times is when we run into our difficult times in marriage, rather than dig down and deal with our selfishness, our immaturities, and our insecurities, rather than do the hard work, we do what we think is easy, and we divorce. And then what usually happens is they get married again and don't deal with those issues, and they move their old baggage into another relationship with their baggage, and it just continues in this cycle over and over again. At some point, you got to deal with the baggage. And it's the same in the Christian life. God starts showing us things. He starts showing me some selfishness, insecurity, hard-headedness, stubbornness, refusal to change. And you have a choice at that point of whether or not you're going to dig down and go deep, let God go deep, deep, deep into your heart. And it's hard, because we have to see things about ourselves that we don't want to see, let alone have to admit, and then let alone have to do the hard work to change. Have I mentioned that the Christian life is difficult? In fact, you will never do anything more difficult in your life than the Christian life. Okay? You will never hear me tell you this is easy, but you will never get anything as worthwhile as you will from the Christian life. Heaven and eternity, when this life is over, with God, with other Christians and wonderful Christians here on earth. So there comes a point in every Christian life, I believe, where you've got to make a decision whether you're going to go all in or you're just going to dabble around with this thing. Brennan Manning wrote a book called The Ragamuffin Gospel several years ago. He wrote this: for the Christian, the second journey begins between the ages of 30 and 60 and is often accompanied by a second call from the Lord Jesus Christ. Brennan is not Nazarene, as far as I know, but man, I read that and I thought he sure could be. I have some notes in there about conversions along the long journey. I'm going to go past those just because I feel led to do that. I think we need to kind of keep bearing down on this issue. But let me say enough about it to say this. I believe that at different times in our life, and I can just use myself as an example, being 55 years old, I'm thinking 10 to 15 years left in ministry. I've definitely got less time in front of me than I do behind me. And mortality is a little bit more of an issue. And how God wants to use me and all these things. And I would say that in the last few years, I've gone through a deeper conversion level of just going deeper, realizing, well, man, I'm not getting any younger. If I don't deal with these issues now, I'm probably never going to deal with them, right? So just the natural processes of life drive some of that. If you get it, say, got it. Then I can save you 5 minutes. Okay. Manning goes on to say this. The second call is a summons to a deeper, more mature commitment of faith, where the naivety for fervor and untested idealism of the morning and first commitment have been seasoned with pain, rejection, fear, loneliness, and self-knowledge. This is scary, isn't it? God starts to show us what's really going on underneath the hood. And that's where God calls us to the deeper call. So the deeper life. I'm going to do something that they taught us not to do in preacher school, and I'm going to switch analogies, okay? I think you're sharp enough to do this with me, okay? If I didn't think you were sharp enough, I wouldn't do it. When I was growing up, one of my favorite things to do was to go to the swimming pool. And my mom took me there regularly, and for some reason I just caught on to it. I remember I just went through progressions. I started in the baby pool. Remember the baby pool? I really remember being in the baby pool all those years ago. And I remember, you know, they had us fenced in because, you know, these little 3 or 4 year olds around water can get pretty scary pretty quickly. I had a death wish. I had 3 near-death experiences to my memory before I was 5. Some kids want to jump one stair. I tried to jump them all. I would not recommend that. Not end well. We had a medicine cabinet downstairs. You know, those big metal things? And I thought, boy, that looks fun to climb. Anybody want to guess how that ended? And I still got a scar right here because of that little incident. And then one day I thought, those mushrooms look good out back. I think I'll go eat some. So that was all before 5. So I was an adventurous person. I needed fences. I needed boundaries. And so I decided to keep moving forward this. My parents very wisely decided, you know what, let's get him some swimming lessons. And I still remember the swimming lessons. You remember getting up about 8 in the morning, and it'd be like 50 degrees, it felt like that, and you'd be getting in the water, and you're freezing to death, and you're doing all your exercises. And they would teach us to, you know, do this number, and kick your legs, and get the rhythm down, and all of that stuff. And to pass the class, you had to swim across the 6th grade part of the pool. That was the big test. My teacher was a lady named Jane. I think it was my first boyhood crush. And she was the teacher, and I was all ready to impress. And I jump in, and I start across, and about 3/4 the way there, something went wrong. And I got scared, and I'm kind of flailing a little bit. And even though I was just a few feet from the edge, I wasn't getting there. And I was genuinely scared. And then, out of nowhere, Jane comes and scoops me up. And how embarrassing that was. I was trying to impress, and she ended up having to save my life, right? And you know, I could have given up on swimming at that point. And I included this for a reason, okay? Our new Christians, they need somebody watching over them. So, you know, for years we thought, okay, we'll get them saved, and we'll just trust them to come to church. We'll just trust them to read their Bible and all this stuff, and they end up drowning because nobody's watching out for them. My parents would have no more let me swim in that pool by myself than they would have done anything, and yet we try to do the same thing with new Christians in the church. You can tell them to come to Sunday school. You can tell them to come to church. You can do all of that stuff. But somebody has got to be taking the initiative to make sure that they're doing it. And watching over them and praying for them and caring for them. Because the devil is going to come and he's going to attack them. So move on. I kept up with the pool and all this stuff, doing all those things. And then as I got older, I noticed there was another section of the pool. It was the deep end is what we called it. Or we'd call it the 12-foot section, or the high dive section. And I would look at it and think about it, and then one day I made the 100-step journey from the 5-foot section to the 12-foot section. They had the high dive and then 2 little ones, right? And I thought, well, I'll probably be wise. I don't know why I all of a sudden got wise at this point, but because I hadn't been wise up to that point, but I thought, I'll do the small ones first. And I did. And then finally the big day came. I climbed up to the top. I walked out to the edge. There were clouds there, as I remember. I looked down, and I'm not going to lie, I thought strong and hard about just turning right back and going back down. But everybody was looking at me, right? Last thing you can do is be embarrassed, right? And finally, I let loose, and I jumped, and my life was changed. I never wanted that five-foot section. I mean, I'd get in and warm up a little bit, but from that day forward, we would cannonball off the high dive. We would do the corkscrew off the high dive. I mean, anything you could do. One day, I don't know, something went terribly wrong. Did you ever land on your stomach? It was just miserable for about 2 days. But I say that to say, there came a point when I had to let go and go all in. And I will say to you that the vast majority of Christians never get there. They will get right up to the edge, but they won't take that final 100-step journey. Sometimes from the seat that they're sitting in on Sunday morning up to the front, what will people think of me? The same thing they'd have thought of me if I hadn't jumped. They probably never would have remembered. Right? We get so wrapped up in what other people think about us. Let me go to a slide real quick. It's called The Second Half. David Busick preached this for us. He talked about how only 11% of Christians move from knowing they're forgiven to a holy discontent, to being broken by God, surrender and submission, profound love for God, profound love for people. That means 89%. This is research. 89% of Christians stay on that first side. They don't go all in. They somehow think that if they give their life to God, it's going to get messed up. And how crazy is that thinking? So I would say to you today, surrender to the second call leads to a great second half. And we're going to watch a video. It's longer. I've tried to compress my message a little bit. It's about 10 minutes, but this video does about as good a job as I've seen of helping put this in our language and where we're at today. I'm going to invite you to watch this with us.
Ephesians 2:10 says that we are God's workmanship, his masterpiece. I don't know about you, but when I get up in the morning and look in the mirror, I don't really see a masterpiece, you know? I mean, maybe a Picasso. It's like, but I want to be his masterpiece. I want to be everything he created me to be. And so I go to him in prayer, and I say, Dear Heavenly Father, do whatever it takes. Mold me into the image of your Son. Make me your masterpiece. In Jesus' name I pray.
Hi.
Whoa. Who are you?
I'm God. You said the prayer, so here I am.
You're not God.
No, I am. You said the prayer. That's how it works.
Okay. If you're God, then make it snow in here.
You know what? I really don't want to make it snow in here because it'd get kind of yucky.
Yeah, you're not God.
Why do you say that?
God wouldn't say yucky.
I do. It's a Greek word.
Oh. Okay. If you're God, what does Lamentations 15:9 say?
Lamentations is only 5 chapters. It's a very short book.
Oh. Why was it so short?
I was tired of lamenting.
Okay. If you're God, who's going to win the World Series this year?
I'm really not into playing games. Why are you so much into playing games?
You are God.
What gave it away?
You answered my question with a question.
I did? Yeah, I do that, don't I? I did it again. Step right up. Here we go.
Okay.
All right.
Hey, what are we doing?
I'm going to make you my original masterpiece. This is the process.
Oh, okay. Got it. Wait. What are these about?
These are the tools I'm going to use to make you into my original masterpiece.
Okay. Hang on.
Yeah.
I thought you were a carpenter.
That's my son. Step right up. Here we go.
Okay. Oh, hey, God. Mm-hmm. How do you know what to chisel away and what to leave?
I take out everything in your life that doesn't belong there, kind of like dead weight.
Ooh, speaking of dead weight, could you chisel right here? It showed up when I was in my 20s and grew around and became back fat. I don't even know why you created that, but I can't get rid of it. I mean, I've tried everything. Like, I tried running. I tried lifting weights. My wife actually talked me into trying Pilates. That was awkward. But I can't get rid of it. So if you would just chisel around here, and then, you know what, if you chisel a line right here, and maybe 4 to 5, maybe 8 lines right here, that would be awesome.
You're funny.
You made me that way.
I also made the platypus.
The platypus.
All I'm saying is most of my children, when it comes to this process, they just want to talk, but they don't want to do the work. So do you want to talk or can I chisel? Talk, chisel.
No, I choose to chisel.
All right. Through my Holy Spirit, I'm going to bring up things in your life that I want you to work on. Like your anger. I created the emotion, but you use it in the wrong way. Compare yourself to others instead of me. You tell little white lies because you want to people please. You're lazy. But you try to fool everybody by looking really, really busy. You have a problem with lust? Well,
time out. I don't really have a problem with lust.
You don't have a problem with lust?
No, I can do it anytime I want. Hang on a second. I mean, I got to admit, I feel like you've been doing some great work, and I'm looking pretty good right now.
All right, when you look in the mirror, who do you see?
I see me.
Okay, then I need to keep chiseling away, because ultimately, you and other people need to see my son.
Okay, don't misunderstand me. It's just, when I look more like Jesus, people get uncomfortable around me. I mean, even my church friends, and they're like, oh, you're holier than thou, you know? And I don't think I'm supposed to make people uncomfortable.
So what you're saying is you'd rather play God in certain areas of your life than for me to be God over your whole life.
That is not what I said.
It's what you meant.
Yes, it is. It's hard to talk to you. You know everything that I'm thinking. I'm just saying you've done some great work. Maybe we take a break, a sabbatical from each other, you know? I'll stay right here, and then,
That's just it. You never just stay right there. You're either moving toward me or away from me, but never you just stay. What you're doing is called control. Do you want to control things in your life, or can I chisel? Control, chisel, control,
no,
chisel.
No, chisel.
All right.
But can we chisel where I work?
That's called control.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
Now this right here, this secret sin that you keep running to whenever you're hurting, angry, lonely, tired, that you think you're fooling everybody, but it's making you a whitewashed tomb. Are you ready for me to chisel this out of your life?
Yeah.
See, it's a process. It's not a sprint. It's a marathon. It's your whole life. And you care so deeply about what other people think of you. It's rubbish. It's garbage. The greatest thing you're ever going to hear is at the end of your life when you hear me say, well done, good and faithful servant. That's what you keep your eye on. That's the prize. Heavenward.
Oh, that hurts.
Oh, trust me. This hurts me more than it hurts you.
Right. Okay. I'm sorry. I don't think you understand this pain.
Pardon me?
You're asking me to sacrifice a lot, God.
Don't talk to me about sacrifice. I know all about sacrifice. I sent my son to die on the cross for pain, for sin, but I also did it for another reason, to give you freedom. Do you know what insanity is? Insanity is doing the same thing over and over and over again, expecting different results. And there are things that you've been doing for years. These empty wells that don't have anything to offer. You've been going to them, and it's insane. Allow me to chisel them out of your life. Allow me to produce character where you keep focusing so much on your image.
Okay, but I was thinking.
Your thoughts are not my thoughts.
Okay, but if we went another way.
Your ways are not my ways.
Oh, I can't.
You can't what?
I can't be good.
That's your excuse. That's your excuse, is that you can't be good.
It's not an excuse. I can't.
Oh, my child. In the beginning, I said it was good. I made you good. Be good.
Yeah. But you and I both.
What? No, what is it?
Nothing, okay? You wouldn't understand.
I, God of all the universe, wouldn't understand something one of my children has to say. Try me.
It's just, I let you down so many times, God.
No, my child. You were never holding me up. I hold you up with my victorious, righteous right hand. Never the other way around. In this relationship, I hold you up.
Chisel away. Just be prepared for what you're going to find in me. Because I know who's inside. Because I get up every morning and I look at him in the mirror and I hate who I see. Because deep inside there, this little kid who gets up every morning and dresses like an adult. And I go out and I try to do what I'm supposed to do, but I can't, okay? I can't be who everybody else expects me to be. God, I can't even be who I want to be, much less who you created me to be. And so inside is this scared, stupid little kid. But you chisel away. Just be prepared.
You have listened to so many voices for far too long that were not from me. And you have totally bought into the lie, haven't you? You think you're junk, don't you? When you lay your head down at night after you've done the dance to get the hug, you think you're junk. Listen to me. I don't take time to make junk. How can I show you that my love for you stretches as far as the east to the west? That how can I show you that my love for you has no end? I know. Reach your back pocket.
What?
Reach your back pocket.
Why?
Are you arguing with me? Reach your back pocket.
God.
Yes?
I just meant, God, I'll do that right now.
You're just saying my name in vain.
Come on. It's a name. It's a saying.
It's a name above all names. It's more than a saying. It's more than a name. I want to teach you something about my name. Reach in your back pocket.
Oh, my God. Shh.
You know what that is?
Yeah, it's a note. I wrote it when I was in college. How did you get this?
Hello?
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead, read it.
I love Angie.
Other side.
Sorry. Dear God, did I hear you right today? Did I hear you say that you love me? Even though you and I both know I've messed up so many times. Did I hear you say you want to use me? And I feel so useless. If you'll take me, then use me. God, I give you all that I am. Take me. I love you, God.
I love you too. And I love you too much just to leave you where you're at. This salvation that you hold, I don't want it to be some sentimental gush or some head knowledge. I want you to work it out in every detail of your life. And when problems come and chaos happens, don't look at it as a prison, but look at it as a father disciplines his child. A father disciplines the ones he loves.
I know, but it's going to be tough.
Yes, but you bought into the lie thinking everything was going to be easy when you gave everything over to me. There will be trouble in this world, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. I want you to do something. I want you to look out there and I want you to say, Tommy is God's original masterpiece.
Tommy is God's.
No, not the way you see yourself or you try so desperately for others to see you. But maybe for the first time in your life, the way I see you, the way I created you.
Tommy is God's original masterpiece.
Yes, you are.
And so are you. God doesn't need junk. You are an original masterpiece.
Surrender to the second call leads to a great second half. I showed you a statistic that says 89% of Christians in America are still living on the I'm in control side. If that plays out in this church that way, I think there's about 100 people. That means about 89 of us are on the I'm still in control side. There comes a point in every Christian's life when you got to decide if you're going to be in control or God's going to be in control. Are you going to jump off? And some of you are thinking, man, it's so scary. Let me share some words for you that I think will help you with your fear. Paul wrote, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16, I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his spirit in your inner being so that Christ may dwell in your heart through faith. Now hear this. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. God doesn't make junk. He made you, and when we finally let go, we find ourselves in the arms of the one who laid out his arms on a cross for our sins. And I think we can trust a Savior who loves us that much. What do you think? If you haven't ever done that, the place to begin is to jump. Say, God, here I am. I've sinned. I've failed you. Today I want to surrender my life to you. I'm putting my faith in Jesus for the forgiveness of my sins, and invite you in to change me and to make me more like you. But Christians, really talking to us today, what this world needs to see is Jesus. And the only way that can happen is if we get out of the way and let Jesus have control and live for us. You're not perfect the moment you do this. You know what happens? You're perfectly committed to becoming all that Jesus wants you to be. And whatever he needs to chisel away, you're not going to fight with him about it. You're going to let him do it. Would you stand with us? This is the meat and potatoes of this sermon series. Some of you just need to surrender. Whether it be your first time, or whether you've already committed to Jesus. Some of you had a relationship with God at one point, and you've been dragging your feet on jumping in again. I would just say today is a great day for all of us to jump in. Father, we come to you this time in this service. God, I pray that you would work and move through the power of your Holy Spirit to do something brand new in each one of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we sing this song, I'm just going to ask you right now to come from your seat. You can kneel at the altar, you can stand, but it's time to do some surrendering, whatever that looks like for you today. Come as the Holy Spirit leads you. Against the lies of the enemy, any of the excuses of the enemy, any of the working of the enemy. Lord, I pray that as we enter into this time of the service, this may be the most important 5 minutes of the lives of our people here today. Everything hangs in the balance in our life when it comes to our relationship with you. Please, Holy Spirit, help us to be obedient to you. I'm not going to labor this, but keep your heads bowed. How many of you just say, Pastor, I need to surrender? Just raise your hand. Thank you. Raise your hand. Just be bold. Why not do it today? Why wait? Why spend another day miserable? We'll sing one more verse if nobody comes. In fact, this will be the last verse regardless. This works. Do what he would have you do. If you want to come pray with these who have come, feel free to do it at this point.
Drench my soul with mercy and grace, unfold my hunger and thirst. surrender. I surrender. I want to know you more. I want to know you more. I surrender. I surrender. I want to know you more. I want to know you more.
Invite some folks to come pray with these who are at the altar. Let's not let anybody be alone if we could at this point. And I just want to say that there's nothing magical to this. It's just a simple expression to God in prayer of our desire for Him to have complete control of our lives. You might want to pray this prayer with me right now. Father God, I come to you. I surrender my life to you. As the words of this song said, Lord, I'm willing to let you have control. I'm willing to let you chisel away wherever you need to chisel away. And Father, here today, I want to die to myself. I want to be cleansed of me. And I want to be filled with you in control. And I release every area of my life to you. Nothing off limits. And whatever you want to do with me, you can do that with me. Jesus, I invite you into my heart through faith. Name of Jesus, I would just say to you today that if this is what you need to do, you need to surrender completely. I would add to that that you also need to surrender deeply. It's been said that the church in America is a mile wide and an inch deep. We need to let the Holy Spirit go deeper than an inch in our hearts. We need to let Him have room in our hearts, as we talked about last week. And I would add that you need to surrender daily. In fact, I would say do that every day. Surrender completely, surrender deeply, surrender daily. God bless you. Thank you for joining us today. Have a wonderful day in the Lord.